My name is Svetlin Nakov, and my talk will be introductionary about the blockchain, about all this shit which makes the Bitcoin bulbs and things like that. So I'll start with about the blockchain, how the technology works from a partially a technical side, partially the economical side. And later I will talk about the things like ICO, Ether, Ethereum blockchain contracts, smart contracts, things like that. And I will also talk about how this would affect our current economy system. And first I will tell a few words about me. And some people say that I'm just Nakov. But I'm a trainer, a founder of the Software University, author of some books, many things like that. And in the latest time, I'm a blockchain enthusiast, and I'm part of some blockchain projects, part of token sale events and things like that. But my main major power is about training software engineers, training engineers who are really good and who are really strong in making software. So I was part of the National Academy for Software Development 10 years ago, or maybe more, the Telerik Software Academies. I was trainer in the Sofia University, in the New Bulgarian University, in the Technical University, where I was, my contract was stopped by the rector. Very nice. This drive me to make better and bigger and bigger initiatives, but I will talk about blockchain. The blockchain, the things which changes our world, and the technology which everyone should be aware of, because it's a matter of time that major processes in our economies will be driven by the blockchain technology. And it's a very interesting time that this technology is currently built. Like, for example, 20 years ago, the web technologies were built when language was JavaScript was first arised, and now it's the time for the blockchain. So what is blockchain? It's a kind of distributed ledger, some kind of database which has its own copy on multiple nodes in a peer-to-peer network, a network which consists of the so-called miners, купачи. Купачи with very big computing power, who invest in CPUs, in graphics cards, in specialized hardware, majorly in China and in Asia. And this network holds a ledger of facts. Facts like Stoyan has 100 bitcoins. This address has these coins. Some facts. You can store facts about properties. For example, this house is mine. Or things like the temperature outside is 20 degrees at this moment. Some kind of facts. And it's decentralized, which means that the blockchain has no owner. Even their creators have no ownership and no control over this network. And there are many blockchain networks, for example, the Bitcoin network, the Ethereum network, which are one of the biggest, but as well as private big blockchain networks, which run for corporate purposes in some big corporations. Currently, the bank system is leveraging the blockchain technology in order to say goodbye to the SWIFT transfers and make all of them through the blockchain, and this is currently happens through the Ripple cryptocurrencies. And the blockchain is by design secure, which means that the transactions are public and they are verified by the entire network. This means that, for example, someone transfers 5 bitcoins from my account to some other account, and I sign this through a cryptographic with a cryptography. I have a private key, which is stored securely on my hardware ledger or somewhere else. I'll talk a bit later. And if I sign that I approve the transfer of few coins from someone to another address, from some address to another address in the network, this transaction is copied in all the nodes. And this is some kind of network of databases which has millions of copies. So it's unstoppable. In fact, it's unstoppable because you should stop the electricity in all the planet or destroy all the countries. And this is impossible practically if the network is large enough. Okay, the most of the Bitcoin network is in China, but even if you stop China or if you control China, this will not give you control over the entire network, because if someone cheats or makes invalid transaction, this is possible, but everyone else will see this because this is public information. All transfers are recorded and they are public, and this grows. Every 10 to 30 minutes, or depends on the network, a new block is created, and this block holds all the transactions validated by all the peers in this network. So it's immutable. Once I transfer some money, it's immutable process. I cannot say, oh, this was a bug, or oh, this was a mistake, I want my money back. I will ask the government to return this money because there were taken from a fraud, for example. You cannot do this. You can make the opposite transaction if the opposite address agrees to do it. That's the only thing. And it's uncontrolled. So the governments are very unhappy because this shit is something that they cannot control. Absolutely, they cannot control the blockchain network. And that's why it's growing, because people say, hey, I have money, which money are not generated by some bank or some controlled by the government entity. Because in case of war, what will happen? The normal money, the fiat money, will change their value. Not only in case of war, but the same things may happen with the blockchain money, because they are even more virtual than the US dollars, for example, which are held by a private bank. Okay, so the concept and the reason it's called blockchain is because it is a chain of data blocks. And each data block has a so-called fingerprint, which is something like some kind of signature, which confirms that by all the participants in this network that the records inside are correct. There is no fraud. There is no case. For example, I transfer some money which I don't have. I transferred 1,000 bitcoins, but I don't have them. This will not be possible until all the participants will agree, or the software of all the participants agree. Because if you are a miner and you run some kind of software, it could do something different than you expect. For example, if they hack your farm, they can change your software and let it do something which is not correct. But you should hack all the participants in the network and change all of their software in the same time. So it's really secure, and I want to show you what are the transactions through this white demo. This is the Etherscan. Is a site which scans the transactions. These are the transactions made 23 seconds ago, where the block was created and validated by the entire Ethereum network, for example. So this is the number of the ID of the transaction, this is the from address, and this is the to address. Addresses are something like the IBAN. If we talk about the traditional system, everyone could have one or more IBAN accounts. This is unique address of your bank account. In the blockchain, you have something like this address, for example. This address is associated with some private key, and the person who knows this private key or have it in his laptop or his mobile phone or a hardware ledger or something like this, he can operate with this money. And because of the public-private key cryptography, it's not easy, or even it's considered impossible, which is not proven, that if you know the address, you can know brute force and guess what is the private key. If I know the private key of some person who has thousands of ethers, for example, thousands of money, if I can guess this private key, I can steal the money. That's why in the era of quantum computing, it will be interesting, but yes. I'll discuss this at the final. So another demo is the blockchain info. This is for the Bitcoin, similar thing. And these are the transactions. At 3 minutes ago, the next block was created and validated by the entire network, and it was stored. So everyone in this network has these transactions and knows who, what address, how many coins it has. So the relationship between the, an address and the person is generally something which is not clear. For example, I don't know who holds this address. This address belongs to someone. He could be a publicly identified person declared. For example, I can say, Nakov, my public my public address is this. If someone wants to send me money, please use this address. But I could have many addresses in many blockchain networks, and I could keep private some of them, and some of them could not be private. So that's why this is this gives a very wide place for fraud. Not fraud, but for non-legal transactions. Things like, for example, I install a Tor client, I go at some drugstore in the Tor network, in the dark web, and I purchase some drugs, some illegal drugs to open your mind, for example, for the seventh chakra. And I pay with some address. And I can be traced, yes, with Ethereum or Bitcoin, I could be traced because once I take some money from some exchange, I put my credit card, I go to exchange, I purchase some Bitcoins, and later I pay for drugs. This is not a good idea, don't do this. Use Monero or something anonymous if you purchase drugs. But this is one of the reasons this thing grows, because the digital money is something that is could be anonymous. It's not always like this, but it could be. It could be illegal, which means, for example, in the Arabic countries, women cannot have money, they cannot have a car, for example, or property. So they take money from their husbands and invest in the blockchain. So that's how they break the laws in this country. But this is not the only things. In China, the old people just replaced the traditional hazard like poker with playing with Bitcoins. That's part of the balloon which comes. Let me show you a little bit more. The blockchain is a technology. Please don't associate directly cryptocurrency with blockchains, because these are different things. This is something like computers and Dota game are different things. The same is like for the blockchain. Blockchain is a technology which can allow you to create cryptocurrency, but which can allow you to create smart contracts. So cryptocurrencies were the first real world application with very high value for the economy. It's, in one sentence, digital money with no central bank, which has not ownership, which is good and bad. Good because nobody can just print some money to save it from some crash, like United States do when they have a crash. They have a very good way to add more money in the economy, just from nothing. And also, the blockchain has very interesting application, which is called decentralized apps. Decentralized apps are a new era in the economy, because they allow people to have a smart contract, one person with another person, or one entity with another entity, which is not controlled by the government. This means no matter what. Just a little example, a startup created blockchain-based company, which says, you put one Ether, if your flight gets late, you will be given 100 Ethers. For example, just a little example. And this is uncontrolled, and this is unconditional, no matter what. For example, if you have insurance about your flight, and it's being, when it's being late, you will get compensation, you should go at some guy and say, oh, it was late in my flight, please give me money. Oh, do you have the ticket? Oh, the other part of the ticket is lost? Fuck you, I will not pay you. And with the decentralized app, you don't have people. You can build economy which is entirely software driven, which is no people, no ownership. Once I create the contract, I deploy it, I'm not the owner. This is a company which have no employees, which have no owner, and it just works. It's very strange. For example, another example of decentralized app is something which just reports the weather temperature in Sofia. Every 5 minutes, it stores a transaction in the blockchain network and says, now it's 25 degrees, now it's 26 degrees. And some people pay to this contract to tell him how many degrees is the temperature in Sofia. And this is a service. It does not have owner. It has owner because of the physical hardware. But this is called an oracle. Oracle. Not to be associated with this corporation with the same name. And they enter in this industry the way to communicate with the real world, to mix real world data with smart contracts, because if I put 5 bitcoins that Levski will win the next week match in football, and you put 5 bitcoins that CSKA will win the next football match, the next week, for example, the smart contract will say, oh, this is the winner, and we'll transfer the money. And this is something which can be done automatically without, it's irrevocable, completely irrevocable, and it's called by code. That's why it's so important for developers, because developers will be layers, will be people who write these contracts. They are digital people who write contracts. So the next big application is for digital investments, for the people who make big balloons, people who just purchase some coins in order to sell them when the price is higher. And this constantly happens, and it will break, of course. So fundraising, ICO, initial coin offerings, token sales, and things like that are a new instrument for funding startups and other ventures which are based on digital cryptocurrency and which are very, very hot topic today. And governments cannot completely control this, because officially they can say, oh, ICO is not allowed. Okay, it's not allowed, but how you trace my computer? It's not possible, because I can use VPNs or I can do it a smart way. A few about the blockchain platforms. We have many blockchain platforms, so many networks, like you can install different games on your computer. Okay, the same way we can install different Bitcoin platforms and take part in different blockchain networks. The first and the most famous was the Bitcoin, which was application of blockchains for the first famous cryptocurrency in the world. Ethereum was the first famous smart contracts platform. This is a so-called next generation blockchain, because it allows developers to write code, and this code runs inside the network. This means that you write some piece of code, and this runs in 10 million machines. 10 million times this code will run somewhere, so you should write it the smart way, because it has some cost called gas. You need to pay for your code to run everywhere, but it's very small fee. Let me show you some of the coins. I will not say a lot. The Whitecoin is something similar to Bitcoin, but have some advantages over it and some differences in the algorithms, technology, etc. Monero is interesting, and Dash, because these are anonymous, and Monero is even untrackable by design. This means that if I pay you something, You get the money, but no one in the world can not know that this transaction happened. It has very highly encryption, and this is for the gangsters very, very nice. For example, if someone steals some money, for example, 1,000 bitcoins, the first things to do is to go at some exchange and to make them, convert them to Monero, and Monero is untrackable. That's how they work, because there are many security issues, bugs in the contract that allow you to someone to steal some money. And this is a real problem. For example, one of our partners was subject of $20 million steal from their multi-signature contract. It was public bug and so on. Let's tell you a bit about the farms. This is a Bitcoin farm, like traditional farm, but there are no pigs inside and food. There are computers inside with some electricity. Two major costs. The first cost is the hardware, and the next cost is the electricity. That's why in countries like Taiwan, where people don't know what is computer, it's full of Bitcoin farms because and other cryptocurrency farms, because the electricity is very, very has very low price. So the farms, they do two things. The first is to validate transactions, to validate, to keep a local copy of the database of this distributed ledger, and to ensure that no one cheats in this network, and there are millions of such nodes. And the second is to mine coins. These farmers solve a cryptographic problem, which is something like find the biggest number which has the following property. And there is no efficient way to solve this problem. And the contributor in the network who finds the solution for the current block for this cryptographic problem is awarded to have some bitcoins or some digital currency, for example, 20. The winner in this competition in the network is awarded some money. This is the motivation for the mining agents to run the mining process. And there is many things in details that maybe Martin will talk about, like difficulty of the network, like how often a new block is created, what happens if the transactions are more than the block size, what about the gas? And the second thing is to get paid for validating the transaction. So if you put your computer to be part of this network, it will be some kind paid in order of gas with very, very, very small amounts in order to keep this network running. And usually, and maybe always, these farmers are combined in pools, because finding the biggest number that have some cryptographic property is something which can be solved by chance. Just for example, if we have all the people in this hall, if some all of them try to solve this program, this problem, all of you can just generate a random number and keep the biggest possible, okay? And after 5 minutes, I say stop. Who has the biggest number? You. Okay, you are awarded. But I can tell that my table will work together. And if someone of us guess the biggest number, we will split the award equally or proportionally to the power I put. That's how mining pools work. And there are lots of mining pools. And usually they have different algorithms, different capacity. For example, this mining pool called GrowSO has this 8.38 giga hash, millions of hash operations per second, something like this. I will not go into more details, but there are many, many, many pools. This is some piece of this, because you can run your own pool and participate in this process. So let me tell you a bit of the traditional about the traditional money, also called fiat money, money who are issued and guaranteed by the government. Some governments say, okay, for example, in the United States, they say, I issue dollars, and these dollars are accepted by law in every trader or entity in this country, or even outside of this country, and it's guaranteed by the real economy. If my country develops more products and its GDP is high, this money, which corresponds to this economy, will grow and they will be more expensive. That's how it's working in the traditional world. And there is some kind of central bank, for example, the General Reserve, Federal Reserve, or BNB in Bulgaria. And it's guaranteed by the government and in some cases by the army. I'll show you how. For example, did you remember Libya, Iraq, Saddam Hussein, Gaddafi? They tried to say, I will not accept US dollars. I will trade petrol through different currency. And what happens? The democracy comes. And democracy comes with jet fighters, with tanks, with soldiers, and the balance is again normalized. That's how the normal economy works. Yeah, this is the world we live in. So if you have some fiat money, they are guaranteed by the government and by the power of this economy and by the power of the army of this economy or economic union. Okay? And what happens with cryptocurrencies? They are first not guaranteed. This is the major property. That this means that there is no real economy behind the Bitcoin. And everyone knows this. And everyone knows that he purchases something which does not exist. Something which is not, which is virtual, which is, which they purchase expectations. The only thing you purchase when you purchase Bitcoins is expectation. Your expectation that it will cost more in some later moment. That's all. And if many people have expectation to go upside, the price goes higher. If the people have expectation that something happens, the bubble will burst. And this will happen. This definitely will happen, but it's unpredictable. How, when, etc. For example, if a quantum computer is invented, and it will be able to guess your private key, this means that if you know the address, which is public, of someone who have 1,000 bitcoins, and if you have a computer which can guess his private key, what you can do? Oh, give me this money transfer. And this will happen someday. And then a quantum cryptography and quantum-based blockchain algorithms will take place and replace our networks which run at this time. Let me talk you about a few things about wallets. What are wallets? Traditional wallets are some physical thing and you put banknotes inside, some euros, some dollars, some leva, and this is wallet. Or you can have a safe and put inside and lock it. The crypto wallets are some repository which keeps the private keys along with some other technical information, public keys, etc. And they keep your blockchain assets. For example, they could call multiple addresses with their corresponding private key. It's free to generate a new address in the blockchain network. You just say, please generate a private key. It generates it, gets an address along with this, and you put some bitcoins. How you put some bitcoins? Someone makes a transaction and transfers some bitcoins from his address to your address. So you can transfer like the normal bank accounts. These are pieces who keep IBAN and the rights to transfer the money to someone else. This is a digital currency wallet. And it could hold Ethereum, Bitcoins, and other things. It could hold things like, which are told tokens. Tokens and coins are different ones. Coins are digital currency, and tokens are something that smart contracts produce according to some different rules defined by the creator of the contracts. ERC-20, for example, is the Ethereum major standard for cryptographic tokens. So you could have software wallets. It's not a good idea. You will be hacked now or later. Don't rely on this. This is my 5 cents about this technology. This is something that you keep in your mobile phone, some private keys. Okay, if they steal your phone or if they put a Trojan horse or some spy software, you are, most of you are developers, you know what I'm talking about, they could steal your digital currency. There are hardware wallets which are considered secure because like the smart cards in the crypto ecosystem, they keep the private key, which is not extractable. There is no way, or at least the producer says so, to extract the private key outside from the wallet. And if you want to transfer some money, this wallet has a screen and it says, oh, you are asked to send, for example, 10 ethers to this address. Do you confirm? So they cannot, even the wallet is put through the USB inside your computer. Software or hackers who control your computer cannot confirm because this is a physical press of button, confirmation button, and they should come to you with a pistol here and say, please click the button and enter your passwords. That, which is, can be done with the traditional money as well. Okay, if you have a bank account with IBAN, it's the same scenario. And there are online wallets. Most people who enter this industry go to Coinbase or some other crypto exchange or my Ether wallet or service like that, and they generate private keys for you. This is a matter of trust. Like you trust to the bank. For example, my money are in some Bulgarian bank. I trust that they will not steal my money. And they usually don't. Usually. The same thing is with the cryptocurrencies exchanges. They keep your private key and they give you some kind of password, the same way the Google Chrome, which says, oh, do you want me to remember your password? You will enter in this site easier, okay? The same thing. So this is also not secure. The only thing which is considered secure are hardware wallets because they are not completely controllable by software. There are lots of cryptocurrencies exchange services. And how they work, they keep a digital wallet for you, for example, Bitcoin wallet, and you have some currency inside, for like this. And you can transfer wallets or you can purchase, you can transfer coins, or you can purchase coins. For example, I put my credit card, I say, please, these $20, convert them to Ethereum or to Bitcoins. It takes the course, the current course, and purchases, and you have incoming transaction from some address which belongs to this exchange service, and this is how you get the money. I'll show you a bit later about this. And there are many providers. I've listed some of the biggest in the world, which have a few hundred millions per day volume. Yeah. Okay. A bit about the smart contracts. Smart contracts is code running in the blockchain network. This is some code which says, for example, if the date is today, you can put some Ethereum and I will issue some kind of, for example, WOC token 100. If the date is December, you can put some Ethereum and I will issue you something else. For example, 50 WOC tokens. They can have some logic like for loops, like things like that. They could keep value inside the contracts because it has some data and it has also some logic. It is something like mobile transferable duplicated into million machines, a piece of code plus data. Contract has own data plus own code and own logic. This is how the token sale events happen. I'm part of one of the Bulgarian projects about this, but I will not have time to talk about it. But we have some pre-sale price, hold it in the smart contracts, and it says, until this date, you can purchase WOC tokens in 650 for one Ethereum. Later, the price changes. Finally, the contracts could send some of the Ethereums or some of the value inside to other contracts. For example, I can quote in my smart contract that if you pay some money, for example, I'm a charity organization. I write a smart contract which says, once some money enter inside, I will split them into two pieces. 50% will go to Africa for the people in Africa, and 50% will go to China, for example. And this is automatically. This is just a code with some calculations, and it's written in a platforms like Solidity. This is a piece of Solidity code. It works like C sharp, like Java, like JavaScript, something like this. It's strongly typed language, and it has development tools, debuggers, and it has a virtual machine. Do you know the Node.js virtual machine or Java virtual machine? It's something like this. It's invented by Vitalik, who is a Russian Canadian guy, who have a lot of billions due to producing the first such platform, which allows to write code in a language called Solidity. And this is very highly paid, something like $20,000 per month. It's a usual salary for a strong blockchain Solidity developer. Strong, not junior. Depends, you know. Like Java developer and very senior Java developer, it's different. And why it's so important to have a senior Solidity developer? Because juniors will make security issues. And if your contract is not well written, some hackers could steal your money from the contract. If you forget one if check, they could cheat you. So Solidity is something which is growing, and there is a big demand for developers. That's why we train people in Solidity, but it's, I don't need the marketing, I already have it. How do smart contracts work? You want, for example, sell your house, and you enter, put a record in the smart contract and say, okay, I'll sell this house for example, 10,000 bitcoins or one. And sometimes someone other participant say, oh, I want to buy it. And he executes this through some kind of registry, and this blockchain puts a record in the blockchain that this house is no longer yours, it's already yours to the other guy. Yeah, this is not possible currently because we don't have blockchain notaries, or at least they are not government approved. You need a notary. See, in the normal world, you trust the notary. If you want to purchase a car in Bulgaria, you should trust to notary. If the notary is fraud notary, you can purchase the president's car. This was happening in the past, you know, in Bulgaria. Yeah, it's possible. The same is for this digital notary. And these things are new players in the ecosystem because they connect the real world with the digital world. And this is a challenge. This is thing which will emerge during the next few years. How the digital notaries will be put, how the, for example, digital voting could be implemented through blockchain, but how the security will be guaranteed and things like that. And this is the long future. It's not currently running, but this is the vision about how the blockchain will change our world. A few points about the initial coin offerings. This is ICO, like IPO is to make a company public, to take from investors some money and to grow this company. ICO means that you have a cryptocurrency venture. For example, you create an insurance company which will enter the car insurance industry, for example. And if you have a car crash, you send a photo of your crash to or some documents to some digital oracle, and he will pay you some money. Something like this. This is not an exact business idea, but something. And they say, oh, this idea is great. I want to invest. I will change the world. Everyone is happy, happy, happy. And they say, I want $100 million, for example, to implement this. And they put an ICO. And they say, please, people, pay this and you get a piece of this business. One scenario. Or you will purchase some kind of tokens, and once everyone uses these tokens to make an insurance, its price will grow because everyone will have to purchase tokens in order to make an insurance policy. Yeah. Things like that. It's very deep topic, which could be another talk, but this is ICO. When you run a new cryptocurrency venture or major a new blockchain network, different than Bitcoin and Ethereum, you create ICO. Sometimes you create token sale event, which is something similar, but it runs on top of Ethereum through a smart contract. I was part with this, with one such token sale event. I will show you an example. It is a company, which company says that it will eliminate the middlemen in the travel sector. For example, I want to hire a hotel room in Dubai, and the Dubai hotel can enter into a smart contract with me without middlemen, which means that I will pay 20% less, or the hotel will take 20% more, or most likely the second. And this is the ICO we created with friends, and we have these token sales. But these are not real money. These are money, but people who purchase this WOG token will be able to use it for travel. This is something like I put 20 euro now and I could purchase now a room for 20 euro in Kraljevo or Albano. But later, when the price grows, my 20 euro now, which are some piece of tokens, could let me to have a vacation on Hawaii for 2 weeks because the WOG token could change its price. It's very interesting. This is the Etherscan, but the token sale is something like possibility for you to enter in a digital contract. Where you enter or not depends on you, and it's made through the Ethereum network. A few things about the corporate blockchain. The first is that it's something strange. Wow, what happens? Corporation has its own blockchain. This is a shit because at first view it's a shit because if all the nodes are in Microsoft, they control the network, right? And they can put invalid transactions, incorrect transactions. Okay, you'll see it. And what if they steal $2 billion? You will see it, and you say, "Oh, Microsoft." So this is a way to enable trust between two companies on the blockchain. And Microsoft says, "Oh, this network is fast. It's supported. It never goes down. It's run by Microsoft Azure." It's not mineable, there are no miners, there is Microsoft, you pay a small fees for your transactions, and they keep it just a decentralized, immutable database. For example, if I say my company will produce this service at this price, and we write this in a smart contract, when this happens, and I have put in the blockchain evidence that I have fulfilled this service, the blockchain pays me. This is something which could be implemented as a logic. So the public immutable ledger, which allows a trust between businesses and allows B2B smart contracts. And you say, why use Microsoft blockchain or Hyperledger or something like this and not use the traditional blockchain Ethereum network? The reasons is that this is faster. This could be real time because it takes time. When I transfer money, it takes time for the transaction to be processed by millions of nodes and to be stored. So this could be faster, this could have other services and other levels of trust and things like that. So A few things about the future of blockchain. It's for the first time in the human history, this gives a tool for democratization and decentralization of core economical processes, which allows to remove the middleman. Like Uber removed the middleman between the people who travel with a car and the taxi drivers who want to provide their car for serving travelers. The same concept applies through a digital contract, and this will disrupt many industries. This is for sure. How? When? What will happen? It's unclear. But this is a disruptive technology. That's why it's growing constantly. It's not about the Bitcoin. The Bitcoin is just a new way of playing poker with bigger expectation. This is just a poker machine. I don't trust in Bitcoins, but I trust in the blockchain as a technology because it will remove the middleman in many, 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 many industries. For example, the central bank is middleman. It prints money, gives to the economy, and allow people to pay one through another, but they control this money. So if they say, I'll stop accepting euro, from tomorrow euros will not be accepted, what happens? But the blockchain has no owner. You write an application, you run it, and that's all. It runs. It's no longer yours. You cannot control it. You cannot stop it. It's irrevocable. It's just a software-implemented bank or software-implemented insurance company. If you have some kind of bugs in the software, it's a problem, but it's not entirely your problem. It's the problem of the community which is involved in the service because it's not your. The contract is not your. The source code could be yours, stored on your computer, written by you, but once you deploy it publicly, it's not yours. It's immutable. It cannot be changed if it has bugs. You just deploy a new version and say to your customers, please use the next version of my smart contract because the old one have bugs, like Bitcoin and Bitcoin Cash. Bitcoin has some weaknesses and they put another blockchain network called Bitcoin, upgrade the network and ask the customers to transfer the community from one cryptocurrency to another. So I believe the biggest problem could be some kind of dramatically improvement in the computers. Not just 10 times faster computers, but exponentially faster computers like the quantum computing with its qubits says it will someday be able to generate the private key for normal Bitcoin account. I don't know what will happen, but this definitely could be a problem, and that's all from me. I think you should be aware of Bitcoin, of the blockchain technology, and as developers, this is the next cloud, the next IoT, the next big thing that you should not ignore. You will learn this now, later, or even a bit more later, but I believe it should be in your portfolio as a developer. Questions? Каже.
So, if you have a Kaggle wallet and you lost it, what would happen?
I have a hardware wallet. The hardware wallet, when you install it, it produces 24 words. You write this on a sheet of paper and keep this paper on separate place. If you have this sheet, you can regenerate the hardware wallet. It's some kind of second wallet, which is not technical, which is paper.
Are you able to have more than one backup to that wallet?
The technology which is widely used works like that. You just have some words which can regenerate the wallet. Multiple backup could be different. If you don't have hardware wallet, you can have your private keys kept into a file. A just normal JSON file, I could show you a JSON file with a private key, with zero tokens in coins in it. Yeah, and this is JSON file. You can write it on a USB stick and have 10 copies in 10 different locations. This is the solution, but it's unsafe because it's just a file. You can copy. You talk about that you could ask a bank to save your paper in a safe. Yeah, this is a normal procedure. So crypto people have different strategies to keep their asset, digital assets. I know people who keep them in several locations who has passwords. So, but you are vulnerable to a physical attack. If they take you at Svetisha and put a bit of Tupalka, you could tell everything you have. So why the normal system? If you have a laptop and electronic banking, they can convince you to transfer the money. The same thing. Other questions?
Ако ще кажа, само ще продължаваме след това.
Продължаваме между другото. We continue with the talk of Martin. Okay, a piece. Something from the organizers. Who will talk deeper about the blockchain at 5 o'clock? Oh, at 5 o'clock. And what will happen until 5 o'clock?
They can go to other calls.
Okay. In this hall at 5 o'clock, Martin Kumanjev will talk about blockchain, but in deep technical details, not like me, just overview. And you are invited until this time you could spend your time around or in the other halls with the other speakers. We have time for more questions, if someone has. Okay, на разположение съм за informal questions. Кажи.
Така, тук говориш малко повече за економика и така нататък.